Now we are doing that, how the HNO3 can be prepared in lab. So before we start, you should be aware of the raw materials which are actually used in the lab preparation of HNO3. So that raw material is actually the petrate. You know now what is the petrate. It is the common name for sodium nitrate. And along with that, it is not only the reactant which is going to be used. There is one more reactant, that is the concentrated sulfuric acid. So these are the reactant which are just used in the preparation of HNO3. So we have a apparatus here. Just look at the figure. What we have? We have a round bottom flask. Don't look like at this moment. Do not concentrate on the things which are present in this or here. Right? I'll be telling you when I'll be just doing the reactions. I'll be telling you accordingly that what I took and what happened actually. So just look for the apparatus which is being used. Right? So it is the round bottom flask joined with a condenser. Right? Here is again a round bottom flask. Here is a beaker. Right? Here is a flame. This is wire gauge and this is a stand, tripod stand, right? So we have these things which will act as an apparatus which are joined to each other so that we can just collect the HNO3. Now the reactant, as I told you, is going to be NaNO3 and concentrated sulfuric acid. So what we do, we take this in the round bottom flask, that is the NaNO3, and along with that we have concentrated sulfuric acid. Right. So what is going to happen? Obviously, the reaction is going to happen. But the reaction do not occur as such, as we need to initiate the reaction. And for that purpose, we are just heating it. As you can see, there is a flame of the burner, which just indicates that we need to provide heat, or we need to heat this thing down bottom flask to make this NaNO3 and concentrated sulfuric acid to react among themselves. Right. Just look at the board how. So this NaNO3 is now going to react with concentrated sulfuric acid, right? When you heat it, you have to keep in mind, which is very important point, that the temperature should be kept below 200 degrees Celsius. I'll write here, temperature should be below this temperature, right? Because there are certain harmful, adverse effect of rising the temperature that we'll be discussing after just completing the reactions which are involved, right? So for this moment, just keep in mind that we need to keep the temperature below 200 degrees Celsius. So I'm just writing here that the temperature is below 200 degrees Celsius, right? So what happens when the temperature is below 200 degrees Celsius? They are heated, they are being heated, I repeat, but the temperature is kept below 200 degrees Celsius. And what happens? The sodium nitrate just react with the sulfuric acid and give rise to sodium bisulfate. And along with that, we get our desired product for which we have done all this process, that is our HNO3, right? So this is the desired product, and how we get it, I think it's clear. Now what happens when this NaNO3 just react with H2SO4, we get sodium bisulfate, and along with that we have HNO3. You know that HNO3, HCl, they are all volatile acids, right? So obviously when they will be formed here, they will get evaporated, right? So the fumes of this HNO3 just rises up. And what happens? We need to condense these fumes, as we need the HNO3 in a liquid form. So what happens? They are made to pass through this condenser, right? And when they get collected here, as I've shown with the drop, that means the vapor, right? So when we just pour cold water over it. So what happens when we just pour cold water? So what happens? They just get condensed. And this is what this indicated by these black dots, that we get our this thing condensed. HNO3. So this is how the reaction happens. Again, I'll repeat what I did. I took NaNO3 and concentrated sulfuric acid in this the round bottom flask. I heat it gently. The important thing which I have to keep in mind, that the temperature should not rise above 200 degrees Celsius. So what happens at this condition? They both react and they just form sodium bisulfate and nitric acid. As we know, nitric acid is volatile in nature, so obviously its fume is it is going to evaporate, and the fumes of it just rises up, right? And it is made to pass through this tube, which you can see. And when it reaches the round bottom flask, what we are doing, we are just pouring we are trickling the cold water over it, so that we can condense the fume of HNO3 into the liquid HNO3. So this is what we have, the HNO3, that is our desired product. And moreover, you can see there is a beaker which contains the water. So, or you can say a freezing mixture, which will just help in condensing the HNO3 further. So, this is how we prepare the HNO3 in lab. Now, the few things which you have to keep in mind, I'm just discussing them point-wise point. Just write in your copies, right? So, the first thing is that then when we get this HNO3, right? Again, I'm repeating, when we get this HNO3, the pure HNO3 is colorless in, you can say, the color. That means it doesn't possess any color, right? But you know that this HNO3 which we get after preparing is somehow yellow in color. Now, the question must be knocking your mind that I said that the pure HNO3 is colorless, but here I'm saying that it is yellow in color. So, you should know that what happens actually when the temperature just rises above 200 degrees Celsius, right? When we are heating it and the temperature just rises 200 Celsius, then what happens? The HNO3 gets, you can say some amount of HNO3 gets self-dissociated to produce nitrogen dioxide in it, and nitrogen dioxide is a gas which has a reddish brown color. So when this reddish brown gas is present in the nitric acid due to the self dissociation of some molecules of HNO3, so this reddish brown color, when mixed with that colorless the HNO3, it turns out to be a light yellow in color. So that is why we get the HNO3 is yellow in color. But otherwise, keep in mind, when I'm talking about pure HNO3, it is colorless in nature, right? So if somebody asks you that what kind of impurity can be present when you are just preparing HNO3 by a lab preparation, so you should be clear that if the temperature rises above 200 degrees Celsius, we may encounter an impurity, and that impurity is not present from any outside source. It has occurred due to the self-dissociation of the HNO3. And what is that impurity? It is the reddish brown gas, that is the NO2. Right, so that is why it imparts the yellow color to this HNO3. And you know, we have certain methods by which we can just purify this HNO3, or we can just get rid of this impurity NO2. And what are those methods? That how we can have a pure HNO3, a pure colorless acid? Just look at the board. So what happens actually, if we need to remove this NO2, we can do by two methods. Basic two methods are used, right? First one is that we can pass dry air through the HNO3 which we get. So when we just pass the dry air or a CO2, even you can pass the CO2. So what happens? It just dissolve this NO2 again, and it just give rise to the HNO3 again. And moreover, the second method is that we can just supply it with the warm water. So what happens when the warm water is there, or if you add water into it and you just heat it, either you add warm water or you add water and just heat it, what is going to happen? Obviously, the H2O will going to react with NO2, and what it will form? It will form obviously the HNO3, and we'll get our colorless acid that we deserve, right? So this is how you can say the methods for removing the impurity, right? Few more things you have to keep in mind. As I told you that the temperature should not be beyond 200 degrees Celsius. Now, what is the reason for that? The first reason is that when the temperature rises more than 200 degrees Celsius, what happens? As I told you that some molecules of HNO3 undergo self-dissociation to produce NO2 gas, which act as an impurity in HNO3. So, what's first reason is that? So, first reason, I repeat. So, what is the first reason? Beyond 200 degrees Celsius, HNO3 somehow molecules get dissociated, and it marks the presence of an impurity NO2. So, this is the first reason. Second reason is that if you increase the temperature beyond 200 degrees Celsius, the apparatus may not be able to tolerate this temperature, and the apparatus may crack. And nobody wants the apparatus should crack, right? So obviously the temperature should be kept to below 200 degrees Celsius. So that is the second reason. So when I talk about the third reason, you know what is it exactly? So what happens when the temperature exceeds above 200 degrees Celsius? What happens? As we all know that this kind of reaction is taking place here, right? But when the temperature exceeds 200 degrees Celsius, what happened? This sodium bisulfate reacts with more petrate to form sodium sulfate. And this sodium sulfate at higher temperature form the hard lumps, which you can say forms a hard lump sticky substance which sticks to the inner wall of this, the round bottom flask. So obviously it interferes in the reaction. So these are the three things which you have to keep in mind, that why we should not increase the temperature above 200 degrees Celsius. I'm just summing up again. First is that it you can say make HNO3 undergo self dissociation to produce NO2, which act as an impurity. Second is that when we just extend the temperature beyond 200, the apparatus, the glass may not be able to tolerate this temperature and may crack. Third point is that we should not exceed the temperature above 200 degrees Celsius, because it may give rise to sodium sulfate, which form at higher temperature form the hard lumps and sticks to the inner wall of the glass, right? So these are the three reasons that you need to keep the temperature below 200 degrees Celsius. Now, the question must be arising in your mind that why I am using this concentrated H2SO4, why am I not using some other acid? So you should know that when you are just using these things, as sulfuric acid is a non-volatile acid, right? So like in this reaction, what you get to see, a non-volatile acid just produce a volatile acid, right? So what happens if you will just use a volatile acid? So you may encounter the fumes of that acid in the HNO3 as well, right? So that means HNO3 will prove as an impure acid, right? So we need a pure one. That is why we use concentrated sulfuric acid, which is a non-volatile acid, instead of using any other acid. Now, if somebody asks you, like I just ask you in a proper question way, that while preparing this HNO3 in lab, why am I not using HCl instead of using concentrated sulfuric acid? Why am I not using the HCl? So your answer should be like that as we know that HCl is a volatile acid, and its volatility is more as compared to the HNO3. So what happens, obviously the reaction is going to take place, but when the fumes of HNO3 just rises up and just they pass through this tube, they will also carry the fume of HCl. As I told you, it is more volatile as compared to the HNO3, right? So it will contain somehow the fumes of this HCl. So obviously when the HNO3 will contain the fumes of HCl, it is not going to be a pure substance, or you can say it may encounter certain kind of reactions in it, and we don't need that. Actually, we need a pure HNO3. That is why we use a non-volatile acid, that is the concentrated sulfuric acid. I think it's clear that how we use apparatus, how we just heat it, what chemical reaction take place it, what kind of temperature is to be fixed, what are the drawbacks when the temperature just extend beyond that 200, and what is the impurity is there, what is the actual color of the pure acid, but when we just obtain, what is the color of that, why it is yellow in color. So I think these are the all important points which you have to keep in mind while you are studying the lab preparation of HNO3.